Okay, in this series of videos, we're going to talk about a new topic called coordinate transformations. So we're going to find many times in fluid mechanics that it's useful if we can express the governing equations in terms of different coordinate systems. So, you know, we talked about already conservation of mass and conservation of momentum, we'll talk about soon. You know, these are all examples of governing equations that we may want to express in different coordinate systems because it may make the equations easier to obtain a solution. So, you know, as a starting point, we're probably all familiar with the Cartesian coordinates. So here, a point in space can be located in terms of three coordinates, x, y, and z. And so to do that, we just take its projection to the x, y, and z axes, and then these three coordinates express the position of this point in three-dimensional space. Now, another useful coordinate system is cylindrical coordinates. And so here, you know, again, I'm showing with respect to x, y, and z axes, but you can locate a point in space also in terms of three variables, but here you can draw a projection down to the x, y axes and define r as the distance from the origin to its projection on the x, y plane, and theta as the angle between the x-axis and this distance r. And then the height above this plane is expressed by the variable z. So cylindrical coordinates, you can express, you know, the same point in space in terms of three components, but instead of x, y, and z, we're using r and theta, which describes its location in the xy plane, and then z, which describes its height above this plane. Okay, so we can write, you know, use these coordinate systems to write not just position, but also velocity. We know that that's something that we're going to be interested in for fluid mechanics. And so remember, in Cartesian coordinates, we can express the velocity vector in terms of three components, u, v, and w. And u times the unit vector I, which is the unit vector in the x direction, plus v times the unit vector in the y direction, plus w times the unit vector in the z direction. Now we can do the same thing in cylindrical coordinates, except our three components are r, theta, and z. So we can express the same velocity vector in terms of v sub r times the unit vector in the r direction, e sub r, plus v sub theta times the unit vector in the theta direction, e sub theta, plus the z component of velocity vz times a unit vector in the z direction, e sub z. Okay, so now we want to know, you know, we define two coordinate systems, and the next question becomes how do we transform between them. So again, I'm going to just look at a two-dimensional case here because you can see probably just by looking at these pictures that both of them have the z component. It represents the same thing in both of these coordinate systems. So just looking at the xy plane for now and considering this point, we can express the position of this point in terms of the Cartesian coordinates x and y, or the cylindrical components r and theta. And just from trigonometry then, we can see what the relationship is between these components. So the r component, the distance from the origin to this point, is, you might notice that this is the hypotenuse of a right triangle. So we can just use the Pythagorean theorem to get that this distance r is the square root of x squared plus y squared. Similarly, we notice that this angle theta is part of a right triangle. So we can express that as the inverse tangent of y over x. And remember that z is the same because that represents the same position in both coordinate systems. Okay, so this already gives us a way to map between these two coordinate systems. So now, not only do we want to map you know, the variables themselves, but we also want to map derivatives between them. And the reason is that, as you remember from the conservation of mass, we're going to end up with differential equations or partial differential equations. And so we want to know how we can map those derivatives from one coordinate system to the other. So let's look at this one, partial derivative of r with respect to x. So this is the partial derivative with respect to x of r. So if we substitute in r in terms of x and y, so that's the partial with respect to x of the square root of x squared plus y squared. So we can take that derivative with respect to x. We get a half times x squared plus y squared to the minus 1/2 times the derivative of the inside, which is 2x. So we get x over the square root of x squared plus y squared. and notice that the square root of x squared plus y squared is equal to r. So I can say that the partial derivative of r with respect to x is equal to x over r. And also, furthermore, if I just look at this triangle, I can see for this right triangle, x over r, that's the definition of cosine theta, right? Adjacent over hypotenuse. So I can write the partial derivative of r with respect to x as x over r or cosine theta. Okay, so let me go to the next slide and continue. So let me just redraw the geometry that we have here in two dimensions, expressing the point in terms of position x and y, and r and theta, and then just let me write here my cheat sheet here of the transformations between r, theta, z, and x, y, and z. And then this is the result that we just got for the partial derivative of r with respect to x. Okay, so now what's the partial derivative of theta with respect to x? So again, I'll take the partial with respect to x of theta, which is arctangent or inverse tangent of y over x. So what's the derivative of the inverse tangent of y over x? So you have to go back to your calculus course and remember these tables of derivatives or identities for derivatives. And you'll find that the partial with respect to x of inverse tangent of u is equal to 1 over u squared times the partial of u with respect to x. So this is just from looking up in a table of derivatives, or if you go back to your calculus book, I'm sure you can find this identity there. So for our case, u is y over x, the term that we're taking the partial derivative of. So if we substitute that in, the partial, so we get 1 over u squared, so 1 over y plus x, 1 plus y over x, 1 over 1 plus y over x squared, that's kind of hard to say, times the derivative with respect to x of y over x. So that's minus y over x squared. So now I can combine these terms, basically multiply the bottom by x squared, and so I get minus y over x squared plus y squared. And we notice here that x squared plus y squared is equal to r squared, because we have a right triangle. So this derivative is equal to minus y over r squared, and then I can factor out a minus 1 over r. And so the reason I'm going to do that is because notice also that y over r here for this right triangle is equal to sine theta. So the partial of theta with respect to x is equal to minus sine theta over r. So let me write that up here so we can refer to it. And then for the z component, well, that's easy because z represents the same coordinate in both systems. So, you know, the partial, and they're orthogonal systems, so the z has no derivative, has no component, has no projection on the x and y axis because it's an orthogonal coordinate system. So the partial derivative of z with respect to x or y is equal to 0. So we get nothing there. Okay, now similarly, we can follow the same argument with these right triangles and take the partial derivatives of r and theta with respect to y. And so we get partial of r with respect to y is equal to y over r, or is equal to sine theta. And the partial derivative of theta with respect to y is equal to cosine theta over r. Okay, so now with these definitions, then we're sort of at a starting point. We have a starting point to transfer between, or to be able to transform between Cartesian and cylindrical coordinates in terms of these partial derivatives. But we still have a ways to go, and we'll continue on the next video.